Taking the boys' club. Like Shobana just said, perhaps there isn't a boys' club. To moderate this session, may I invite now Faye D'Souza, Executive Editor, Mirror Now. Sorry about that earlier, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome, Faye. Captain Kiran Sangwan is a commander with Indigo Airlines and started flying at the age of 16, clocking 4,000 hours in the air. She's proud of working for an airline which has 250 women pilots, the most of any airline worldwide. Please welcome Captain Kiran Sangwan. A mixologist, the first Indian woman professionally trained to mix beverages and tend bars, she runs a training academy called Stir and is a consultant to the beverage and bar industry. Author of several books on beverages, my kind of woman, may I please welcome Shatbi Basu. An intrepid adventurer who began mountaineering in her 30s, our next speaker is the first Indian woman to scale the 7 highest peaks of the world. She was awarded the Padma Shri in 2013 and is the oldest Indian woman to have scaled Mount Everest at the age of 48. Ladies and gentlemen, Premlata Agarwal. Completing this panel is Dr. Shashikala Sinha, the Project Director for Advanced Air Defense Systems at the Department of Defense Research and Development Organization. She led the successful firing of a supersonic interceptor ballistic missile, the third in a, yes, it sounds, that's as great as it sounds, the third in a series last year, making India only the fourth country in the world to have this technology. Please welcome Shashikala Sinha on stage.
Good afternoon, ladies, and the few gentlemen I do see in the audience. I hope you're having a really, really nice time. I'm honored to be here. I'm particularly honored to be sharing the stage with these four women. I feel like I should go back, work for 10 years, and then actually qualify to be here. But I'm so happy to have the good fortune of having a conversation with the four of you. We're going to try and keep this tight because I understand that we're a little behind on the time. So I was talking to each of these ladies backstage, and the stories that they have to share are so amazing that I'm not going to get into the way. I'm just going to let them share those stories with you, because how cool is it to be called the Missile Lady of India? It's so cool. And in this, you know, in the whole lean in, have it all sort of concept, she's a mother of two, you know, she did her master's, you did everything you wanted to do, and you are, and you've also built this amazing career. Tell us, you know, what pointed you in this direction? Because you did engineering, you went to IIT, and we all know engineers in IIT who then eventually just all work for McKinsey. None of them actually build anything. So how did you wind up building missiles for India?
Okay, I'll start with the fact that I have a service background.
Yes.
Because my father was in the army, and my brother is also in the army currently serving, and my husband was in the Indian Navy. And when I finished my engineering way back, I took up a job, and then of course my elder daughter was due, and so I had to quit, and for about few years, 5 to 6 years. And then again, because of an accident, my husband passed away, and I had to, you know, pick my career back. But anyway, we had been planning like, okay, bahut time ho gaya hai, abhi, you know, I've taken a long break, so we need to get back, and you're going to quit the Indian Navy, and I'm going to take my job back. You know, we were actually in the process of planning when this thing happened, and it was like a very, when you plan for something and you execute it, it's very different from when the carpet just gets pulled from under your feet, right? So I had to get back to the job, And at that point of time, I was not even certain how the progress has taken place with respect to the technology.
Yes.
Because when you finish your master's, you're working with especially electronics background or radar background. You have a lot of equipment, a lot of programs, I mean, computer languages that you need to know, and analysis that you need to do. So it's like, it's very tough for you to cross that thing, and you need to push yourself even further to be able to reach that point where you're able to achieve what you would like to achieve. So it's like, the first thing that that came to my mind is the determination that I'm going to prove to myself, first of all, that those 5 years, whatever I've lost, actually do not mean anything. That even if the technology is advanced, I've got to make my mark and I've got to actually be there along with the rest of the world. So that was the first thing. And I used to come back home many number of times, really disillusioned with many things. And my daughter is sitting here, and she used to be my spirit, actually, who's given me the strength. Pavitra is here. She's given me the strength to face situations, to be able to stand up for yourself, especially when you're typecasted sometimes. especially, we actually get into this mode of getting typecasted into certain things. We've been hearing so many wonderful speakers earlier today, and the general tendency is we have this stereotype threat. You know, we enter into that mode where we actually do tend to defend ourselves whenever we are confronted with a situation.
Did you ever have anyone doubt you, question you in your workplace?
Not with respect to capability.
Yes.
Because technically, if you're competent, nobody really questions you. So the first thing that you need to develop is technical competence so that nobody can question your work. But there are certain situations where you may be the only person, only woman in a forum, and you need to get your voice heard. So that's when actually your personality comes into being, and my father played a very big role there. And he made me have this confidence in myself that I am capable of doing something and I can prove myself. So it was my father who gave me that, instilled that confidence in me, and my daughter who gave me the strength that I should speak up for myself, no matter what the situation. So you've got to learn to have that confidence. You have got to be competent in what you do, and you've got to have determination and focus that you have a goal set for yourself and you're going to achieve that goal. That's the most important thing. If you don't have immediate goals, believe me, nobody else is going to set goals for you. You've got to set and it may be a very small goal for a start, you know, but you've got to set goals for yourself. And in the missile complex, let me tell you, it's a scientific community, and we have a wonderful, it's a wonderful environment. There are a lot many scientists, women scientists today, who are doing, they're doing wonderful work and trying to be where they are. But still it's a minority, because science and engineering is a minority. Yes. In fact, 2017...
But when you went to IIT, how many other girls were in your class?
Ours was the first batch, which actually wrote the joint entrance exam for IIT, the GATE exam. So ours was the first batch. In fact, we had a lot of firsts. Ours was the first batch which finished with the 5-year engineering, and the lucky ones after that got to do only 4 years of engineering. So we had to do 5 years of engineering, and then when we finished 5 years of engineering, there was this other batch which was literally passing out, and then the GATE exam came on, and then we were like writing it for the first time. And after clearing GATE, I got the option of entering into IIT. And then, of course, I joined TIFR, then the microwave group of TIFR, and worked for a period of time. So that's how when I got back, I was able to... The fundamental thing is when you learn, I mean, this is for all the youngsters and for the mothers who would like their children to learn. The fundamental thing is the lesson which you're going to learn once. Please ensure that you're learning it properly. You shouldn't have to go back and do the learning. It should just be memory refreshing. That's the most important thing. The foundation right. that you learn in your education, I mean, during your educational period, that's very, very important.
You know, the big learning we can pick up from here is to trust your voice. A lot of times we have women who've worked hard enough to put themselves in boardrooms and rooms where decisions are being made. And I've seen this happen where they sort of are sitting there going, so you know you have something important to say, but you're just not, you don't trust your voice enough to say it. A lot of times as women, we wait to be called upon or asked a question before we say something. I went to school where we were taught that girls should be seen and not heard. I didn't follow that instruction at all. And my advice to all the women I meet is to never follow that instruction and to always make yourself heard. Premlata ji, पहले तो आपसे मिलकर बहुत बहुत खुशी हुई. आप दो बच्चों की माँ थी और फिर आपने डिसाइड किया आप माउंटेनियरिंग शुरू करने वाले थे. आप बताइए, आपकी कहानी बताइए, कैसे किया आपने, क्यों किया?
मैं दार्जिलिंग के पास एक
कौन है
छोटे से गांव से हूँ, सुकिया पोखरी. वहीं से मैं शुरू करती हूँ क्योंकि मैं तो पहले एक हाउसवाइफ थी और हाउसवाइफ से माउंटेनियर तक का सफ़र इतना आसान नहीं था. मुझे बहुत सारे चैलेंजेस का सामना करना पड़ा था. लेकिन बचपन में, बचपन की कुछ बातें बताती हूँ कि मुझे स्पोर्ट्स में बहुत रुचि थी, विशेष करके दौड़ में. और मैं हर साल दौड़ में हिस्सा लेती थी और हर साल लास्ट आती थी. लेकिन मैंने प्रयास करना नहीं छोड़ा, मैं जीतना चाहती थी. जब 18 साल की उम्र में मेरी शादी हो गई तो जीतने की अभिलाषा धरी की धरी रह गई. मैं पढ़ना चाहती थी, कुछ बनना चाहती थी. लेकिन शादी हो गई तो बच्चे भी जल्दी हो गए, दो बेटियां हो गई, जमशेदपुर में आ गई. पूरी तरह से एक हाउसवाइफ का जीवन जी रही थी. मेरे पास न स्किल थी न अपॉर्चुनिटी थी. शादी के 20 साल बाद मेरी मुलाकात भारत की प्रथम महिला एवरेस्ट विजेता बचेंद्री पाल जी से हुई और मेरे उसी समय जीवन का ये टर्निंग पॉइंट था. उन्होंने मेरे जज्बे को एक नया रूप दिया और मुझे माउंटेनियरिंग के क्षेत्र के लिए प्रेरित किया. लेकिन एक हाउसवाइफ का, एक गृहिणी का, दो बेटियों की माँ का इस फील्ड में आना परिवार समाज की सोच से बाहर था, वो भी आज से 18 साल पहले. लेकिन मेरी इच्छाएं मरी नहीं थी, मैं जीतना चाहती थी. विल पावर बहुत स्ट्रांग था, जज्बा था जीतने का, जुनून था, क्योंकि मैं हारने के लिए पैदा नहीं हुई थी. और वो बचपन के बार बार हार कर भी प्रयास करने की इच्छा शक्ति ने, जीतने की इच्छा शक्ति ने मुझे एवरेस्ट के साथ साथ विश्व के सातों महाद्वीपों के ऊंचे शिखरों पर अपने देश के तिरंगे को लहराने का मौका दिया.
जब आप एवरेस्ट क्लाइम कर रहे थे तो वो ग्लव की कहानी बता दीजिए.
जब मैं एवरेस्ट के लिए, उसके पहले मुझे थोड़ी और कहानी बतानी पड़ी. क्योंकि जब मैं एवरेस्ट के लिए गई तो मेरी बड़ी बेटी जिसकी शादी हो चुकी थी वो मुझे छोड़ने आई थी. तो वो तो छोड़ के चली गई. तब शेरपा ने कहा, जो मेरे साथ गाइड था, आपकी बेटी कहाँ है? मैंने कहा वो तो चली गई. मतलब उसे एवरेस्ट नहीं जाना? मैंने कहा एवरेस्ट वो नहीं, मैं जा रही हूँ. बोला आप इंडियन लेडी इस उम्र में, आपका दिमाग तो खराब नहीं हो गया, एवरेस्ट के लिए आई है? और वो मुझे हमेशा शंका भरी नज़रों से देखता था. मुझे जब भी उसके मोटिवेशन की ज़रूरत पड़ती, उसके हेल्प की ज़रूरत पड़ती, वो मुझे डिमोरलाइज करता था. कहाँ आप दादी नानी बनने की उम्र में और पहाड़ पे चढ़ने आ गए.
लेकिन उस एल्टीट्यूड में,
और
जब थोड़ी सी मतलब हलूसिनेशन होने की चांसेस है, जब हौसला की बहुत ज्यादा जरूरत है, अगर आपको कोई डिमोटिवेट कर रहा है तो फिर आप मैनेज कैसे किया?
जी हाँ, तो मैं उसे कुछ भी प्रॉब्लम बताती नहीं थी. जब 27,000 फीट में मेरे ऑक्सीजन में कुछ प्रॉब्लम होने लगे तो मैं ग्लोव पहन, इतना मोटा वो ग्लव्स था कि ठीक ही नहीं कर पा रही थी. मैं उसकी हेल्प भी लेना नहीं चाह रही थी, कहीं वो मुझे वापस ना भेज दे. और मैंने जैसे वो ग्लव्स खोला और ऑक्सीजन मास्क ठीक करने की कोशिश की और तेज़ आंधी चलती है वहाँ तो, और वो उड़ गया. तब तो मैं सन रह गई कि अब मैं क्या करूँ. तेज़ी से पैर ठंडे होने लगे, उंगलियाँ ठंडी होने लगी. बस एक ही ख्याल आया कि मुझे तो हर हाल में जाना है, एवरेस्ट की चोटी पर या भगवान के पास. लेकिन उससे मुझे इतनी एनर्जी आ गई थी कि वो मैंने एक कदम आगे बढ़ाया तो मुझे एक वुलन ग्लव मिला व्हाइट कलर का,
बस पड़ी थी जमीन
जमीन पे, और मैंने बस वो उठाया और तुरंत पहना, उसी से मैंने एवरेस्ट क्लाइम किया। और जब मैं अब वापस आके सबको बताने लगे कि मेरे साथ क्या हुआ, तो सब बोलने लगे कि नहीं वहाँ जाके लोग कहानी बनाने लगते हैं ये वो। तो मैंने कहा नहीं मैं सच बोल रही हूँ। फिर मेरी एक एवरेस्ट की जो क्लाइंबिंग की फोटोग्राफ्स थी उसमें था कि एक में ब्लैक ग्लव्स था और एक में वाइट, वो प्रूफ था।
That's a beautiful story. I want to quickly keep this up before we run out of time. Captain Kiran, that's so cool, right? Say Captain Kiran.
Thank you.
You work with an organization that has a lot of female pilots, but I'm sure every one of them has a different story. I'm reminded of this terrible joke that was doing the rounds. I think it was one of the British comedians who said that, I'd never want a woman to fly a plane because she'd keep yapping and she'd forget to point it in the right direction. Was there a lot of that when you started off?
It happens, and mostly it's not from the colleagues you fly with, it's mostly from the passengers and the society. The moment they realize, oh, you are a captain, you're manning this plane, they will be, they ask my crew, ye ura legi, are you sure, like she's trained to fly? Yeah, I'm trained to fly, my company is not stupid to let me sit there. Huh. You know, but these kind of questions do get thrown at you. But I would say, more than that, we also receive a lot of compliments. Like if the passengers hear a woman's voice and they know it's an all-woman crew or a woman captain, they come up to you, they want to take pictures. So I'm glad at least the society is open to those ideas. It's better than being, you know, being a pilot abroad.
You know, there was a pattern here which I also found very interesting. Everybody talked about their dads. All of the dads had played an important role in making these ladies who they are today. Your dad played an important role
exactly.
too.
Exactly. As any kid, you know, you just like clearing standards and after standards. After 10th board, I had no clue what I wanted to do. My dad was like, okay, is it going to be humanities, commerce or science? I said, I don't know. He's like, okay, then you are good at studies. Why don't you be a doctor or an engineer? I said, I have no interest in any of that and I know I won't be happy. So again, series of discussion over a few months, and I figured out that I want to be a pilot. Had no clue about it. I don't know how it's going to happen, but I want to do it. So, my father is actually from Haryana. So, you know, you have this general stereotype that Jat girls or, you know, people from Haryana, they're not going to let you do something. They're going to just get you married after, you know, you finish your college. And it was not the case with my father. He said, okay, you want to do this? Definitely. Just tell me that you'll be 100% into this. I don't want you lingering around and, you know, that I invest so much in you and then you have no interest in this. I said, no, I will do it. And thereafter, there was no looking back. He has never questioned me.
Other people questioned him?
Yes. So questions were thrown at him that, what are you doing? You know, you're spending so much money on this girl. You already have a son. He's doing well. Why do you need to spend money on her? But he never let these questions come to me. He was like, no, it's my daughter, she wants to do it, let her do it, let her be an independent woman. After that, it's her life. So I'm really glad, like, my father is like that. Even now, like, I've become a captain, I'm 28 years old right now, people still ask me, okay, she has a job, she's well settled, why aren't you getting her married? Again, he says the same thing, she can choose her career, she can choose her man. I don't need to decide that for her. So I'm really glad my father says that.
Did your dad play an important role as well?
I think my first sip was with my dad. So, I think that qualifies. Yes. So, I think that qualifies.
I mean, you lived in Bombay / yes. Mumbai your entire life.
Yes.
But was there a point where people were like, bartender? Raat ko bar mein kaam karti hai? Like, what sort of a job is this? Did you ever have to throw like a drunk guy out saying, I'm not going to give you any more alcohol? Or did people actually walk up to you saying, are you serious? Are you the one who's pouring the drinks tonight?
Yeah, I mean, I had all of that. So it was not just one. It was a mix of everything. So you'd have people say, but why bartending? Why could you not have thought of any other career? And I said, why not? And yes, I had people who would come up to the bar and say, oh gosh, it's so refreshing to see someone like you. We can actually have a conversation with you and you can actually make us a drink. And I said, yeah, of course I can. And you'd have others who would not want to talk to me because ladki hai bhav kya dena, theek hai, let's get the boys to give us a drink. But after a drink or two, they would most certainly start talking to you. And then they would tell you this. They would actually tell you ki, yeah, we were debating whether we should speak to you. Then we thought, you know, why give you the importance? So we didn't, but now we're talking to you. Okay. So yeah, we've kind of had this whole run around, but with my family, it was brilliant because it was my mom and my aunt that bought me my first book.
Is the nightlife slash restaurateur business a boys' club?
No, I don't think it is. Okay. I don't think it is. I mean, they like to think it is, but it's not really.
The boys would like to think a lot of things that we don't.
Yeah, it's true. But it's not really. And I've seen this across the board, not just in bartending, but even in the beverage alcohol industry. The alcobev industry has seen a lot of women coming there. And a lot of people say, so have the men chosen to let them in? And I'm saying, no, it's the women that have actually chosen to enter the field. And that's purely because they believed in what they were doing. And they were perfectly focused. So I think women make better bartenders.
Better investors, better scientists, better pilots, better everything. Mountain climbers,
Look,
better journalists.
I think we're just really good, yeah. I think we're really good. You know that we're better at multitasking than a man can ever be. It's kind of ingrained in our DNA. We smile.
Yes.
Do you know how many times I actually have to tell the guys to smile when they're behind the bar, saying that, listen, we're in hospitality. People come to the bar to drink and to feel happy, and you guys just stand there looking like you're dead. There's no expression. Women, we smile. We're more hospitable.
You know, I have run over time, but in conclusion, I just want to say this. So what I also found very heartening when we were having conversations is that it came up that there are more pilots, women pilots in your company than people would otherwise assume. There are more Indian scientists who are women than there are in the rest of the world. You said it's not strange for a woman to be a bartender. It's not strange for a woman to walk up to a bar in India and have a drink by herself anymore.
No.
And your story is just amazing. You're just amazing. I don't think I can even comment on Premlata's story. She's just amazing. So while they say that behind every successful man, there is a woman, I think behind successful women, what we've proven here is there's a dad, apparently,
yes.
who's
and
encouraging.
And daughters.
Yes.
And,
yes.
Daughters.
And daughters.
There are dads and daughters. And mums are even more important because they're the ones who silently stand there.
True.
And they just are there standing behind us all the time and telling us where to go.
So I think for everyone in this room, we're here because our parents worked really hard to tell us constantly that we're not different from our brothers. And that's why we're here. And we remember that if we constantly tell our daughters that, then we can push them one step further. I just want to leave you with one thought of mine. I get asked a lot saying that there are women in this country who are really fighting for basic rights. The right to live, the right to have children that they want to have, the right to safety. But urban women like you and me have everything. I get asked, what are you fighting for? You're allowed to work, you're allowed to go anywhere, you're allowed to wear whatever you want. What are you still fighting for, you feminist? And my answer to that is, because you think I'm allowed to go to work.
Yeah.
And because you think you are allowing me to wear what I want and to sit where I want, it is my right 50-50 as much as it's yours. And my answer to anybody who uses feminism as a curse word is that unless and until every table where every decision is being made, in this country at least, is 50% female, we're going to keep fighting and there'll always be something to fight for. 20%, 25%, 30%, 40% is not good enough. We are half this country and we deserve half the representation. So our work, we're here because previous generations fought to have jobs, to have careers, to go where they want to go. We now have a responsibility to fight for choices, to hand over a better situation to the generation that will come after us. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you.